I think we have a spec, I have a spec.
This is where we might have to do some action to get it through the window.
Where's Leo?
At least you have those.
If I ever get my computer back, I'll send it to you.
Oh, that's right, that's on the year.
Oh, I know why.
I'll have these copies.
Leave the next one down on the tower.
I think I know where it's at.
What's happening?
Hey, you're talking about who's massive.
You're in a different time zone.
Yeah,
Well, I think it could be my.
Skin's left hand.
I was over to your age.
I wanted to.
Just a couple of years ago.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Okay, it is now seven o'clock.
And we're missing our, first item, second item, so talk slow.
I will. Okay, we have all three selectmen here.
I should talk slow.
What is that?
We have our secretary, we have the town administrator. We will talk slow.
7 o'clock, exactly.
7 o'clock, exactly. We're re-adjourning because at 6:30 we met and we did a library walkabout.
Do you want me to kind of just say, selectmen, the view, the library, attic?
No, just say the library, maintenance issues. Numerous issues. Come back to that discussion. Because you guys gotta give me the direction. Yeah, pretty much. Okay. First thing on the agenda, we'd like to just talk about the old minutes.
I think you have them in your packet.
Yes, I do. May 11th.
I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes of May 11th, 2017.
My name is wrong.
And I'll second that.
Any further discussion on the minutes? Hearing none? All in favor? The minutes being approved?
Aye.
Aye.
Hey, you're trying to public comment. Ask him to talk slow.
You have President Obama in the back there.
No.
Too much hard on the president.
It is. It'll be a family.
Have to be family. Change your name.
Yeah.
Corin?
Yes, sir.
That's Brian Nordle right there. He's on the agenda. Is he okay?
Yeah.
So when he starts speaking, you know.
How are you?
He's a senior.
Should I have him in the room?
No.
Is this your idea?
Yeah.
Yeah, this is mine.
You have the bullet two, and they said in a minute, in a public comment, after public comment, bullet two.
Hey, Lee, is Jeff supposed to come?
Yeah. Yeah, he's always running.
I had another haircut for him.
So you're looking at the agenda?
I don't have it on mine.
I don't have it on mine, I think I got it.
Some of them didn't print properly.
Oh, okay. I just wrote all of mine.
Not the line.
I did.
I have it online.
I might have a draft in my stack.
Yeah, I was working for.
Yeah, place over, that's all.
There you go.
He said that you should go to the same size, that's what he said.
Another tree.
You can go back in there.
Just a little.
Yeah, what's new?
It's Brian.
Brian, spell it wrong? Oh my gosh.
Okay, gonna do public comment from left to right?
Okay, I'm gonna open up the public comment. Please state your name if you have something to say, and then we'll go from there. Okay, we have five members of the public.
They have no comments.
You're on the agenda, you know.
Huh?
You know you're on the agenda, too.
Oh, I know.
Okay.
Don Larson, Birdview Drive, Dunbarton. I just want to say thank you to the police department for their help this weekend with Arts on the Common. We had a lot of people on Saturday, and we got rained out Sunday, but most of the vendors did in one day what they could do in 2 days in the past. And same for our fundraising, our food tent surpassed last year's two-day event with just one day, ran out of food, and which was a good thing, and because it was late in the day. And the raffle tent was $15 shy in one day of what they did last year, which was about $1,860. So we're happy there. We're still getting the bottom line and that on how much we'll be able to donate, but it'll be good.
Sounds like a successful weekend.
And we got most of the signs, I think all the signs picked up all over the area. But if you do see one, grab it and bring it to my house.
Thank you, Don.
Yep.
Okay, I bring it back to the table, to the board, and Don, you're first up again on the agenda. Don't get a seat sold.
Okay. Don Larson, Birchview Drive. I have $104.17 that we gathered through donations during Arts on the Common, and I'd like to present it for the refund per RSA.
Okay. I need a motion.
Yeah. I'll make a motion to accept the funds in the amount of $104.17 per RSA 31:95-B3 for the Reese across Dunbarton for veterans.
One second.
Any further discussion on that? Before I take a vote, I just want to say how much are you towards your goal? You remember
we're at $1,708. I figure, you know, because I've got to get some hooks there to hold the Reese in place so they don't blow off. And that way, about $2,000.
So you're almost there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And
excellent.
We've got the next event will be the Fireman's barbecue, and then we have Old Home Day, and then we have the Chili Supper in December. So between those, we'll be able to fund others. Plus, if I can pick up a couple more corporate sponsors, for 5 years, we'll have that pretty well funded out, and then just keep the donations rolling, and so it'll be enough in there to keep it alive for a long time.
Okay. Thank you. It sounds like you make a good progress.
Thank you, Doug.
I'm sorry, I missed who seconded that. All in favor of accepting the donation?
Aye.
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 Okay. Accepted. Okay, next on the agenda is Brian Noodle, Directory Pond Road.
Yeah.
Come on up.
I thought it was 7:15.
I spelled it.
Guess we're heading.
His first name wrong.
Yep. Head of the girl. Yes.
I got it right on the letter.
Lean.
I said I pronounced correctly.
You did?
Hey, Jeff.
How you doing?
Good evening, Jeff. Please, showing up to me.
Members of the Board of Selectmen, my name is Brian Nordle. I live at 36 Purgatory Pond Road. I was requested, I'm sure that you all got these handouts. Lean had requested this meeting to discuss road improvements. There's a long history to it, but we did do a site walk. Actually, we've done 3 site walks, different parties involved, and then ultimately went to a town meeting March 13th. Not an unlucky day, they voted for it. To just put parameters that if I did upgrade the road, that it would be accepted. Without getting too involved, there's a lot of history to this. The road is a public access to Purgatory Pond, initially bought by the New Hampshire DOT to access the pond. Back in those days, they did what was called a return of deed at a Board of Selectmen's meeting. The thoughts to that were that sometimes these accesses go through several parcels. They didn't want to dictate what happens on the parcels, but they wanted to get to that pond. So they'd come to the Board of Selectmen, get a vote that yes, we'll accept this right away in there. It's an old process that they do. Now, it's changed pretty much to ownership, and that's the gray area, because then if the state owns it or Fish and Game owns it, there's different ways of attacking it. But anyway, the short run is that's the history.
So it does have a public access to that pond?
Absolutely. And basically, according to Fish and Game and the DOT, the town has the authority, if you would, on that access. They just want to get to the pond no matter what.
Okay.
In you know, in basic terms.
And they've never upgraded that access like they have at the other town ponds?
No. That's in these minutes and discussed. I did, one of the first sidewalks I did was with Fish and Game and DOT way back. Just actually when I was purchasing the land to be sure I could get in there. They still have the access and they still will always have the right to get in there. For when I moved in, Simon Audette was the road agent. Beyond that, Jan Vanderbogart, for many years, they would, if there was an ice storm, dirt road frozen, they'd run the sander down. If it was deep snow, they'd wing it back. But we're well aware, I am, that it's a class 6 road and the town does not have to do that. It's not a town maintained road, pass at your own risk. Mm-hmm. There's one other neighbor I have on the road that, when Rainey was selectman, had a different view of it, and those were the first couple meetings I came to just as an observer, if you would, that they wanted it maintained. Once it was because it was a scenic road, which it is not, and once was just, we have the right to have it maintained, which they don't. So at this point, it's 2,000 feet long, not quite as long as Ordway Road and other roads, but I just thought that if I step up to the plate, so to speak, and get it so that Jeff or whatever road agent is comfortable, which I was on the planning board for a while, I know that what a Class 5 road standard is. Real brief history, I worked with Audley Corporation for 37 years. I build roads every day in my dreams. So the intent here is to get a subgrade that will be 32 feet wide. It's different than it, like buying a piece of land and getting a road in. There's some circumstance there, the poles, the right-of-way, what was built prior, and so on. So my discussions with everyone on sidewalks and stuff, I would love to get the subgrade in, get the crown in, and then get with Jeff and look at that point.
Brian, for clarification,
yep.
On the 32 foot,
yep.
What part of that is shoulder and what part of that is road?
The road, Class 5 road is 24, typically if it's paved is 24 feet,
yep.
4 foot shoulders. But I don't want to ever readdress that subgrade. It's easiest to do it to begin with. It gives him a lot of snow removal area.
So he'll have good strong
correct.
Shoulders on that road.
And the ditch lines, they're a minimum below your finished grade. And if you don't get that subgrade out there, then you don't have that.
So you don't have any strength. Okay.
Correct. So I, looking at it, if, because of the pole placement, I can get that with in the alignment of the right-of-way, and I'm doing that. I did want to make comment that in my letter from Lean, not a big thing, it says...
prior to beginning construction,
I began the construction the year of that meeting by purchasing gravel. The 18-inch pipe and the 15-inch pipe are installed. The Scituate concrete pipe, class 3 concrete. Jeff wanted concrete, it's there with end sections. The 12-inch hasn't been put in, just I couldn't keep the pipe crew for another day.
So that, for the 32-foot width, is all in there?
Yes, the pipes themselves are in at the width of the right-of-way.
Yeah.
I did hire John Brown after talking with Lean, just primarily about the attempt to cut the United State Mail. And John Brown has cleared it. And the typical clearing, they thrashed it, but it's back together. And then shortly I'm going to pursue the subgrading. And that, I guess, is in a nutshell. I do appreciate that the board has changed from anyone that was on it. And it is a different approach, if you would, to that road. And I do, there's no time frame because I didn't, even though I work for a road builder, I pay for what I get, if you would. And finances were that I had to buy the gravel, buy the pipes, and they're all purchased now. John Brown was considerable money, if you've ever hired John Brown before.
To do the tree work?
Yes. And that's all. It was because it was growing over the wires. There was a couple of trees that were completely around the wires, so bucket trucks were needed, so on and so forth. That's complete. Memorial Day weekend, we're going to stump it, remove all the rocks. With one of the operators that work in an excavator. And then the drainage is the same configuration, if you would. One pipe was moved just a little bit because the existing pipe was shallow. You couldn't get coverage and you couldn't get drainage where it was. So it was moved probably 50 feet and put at an angle that we could get it lower in the road. I guess that's the basics to it. And then again, my goal was to get with Jeff, once it's sloped, is that Dunbarton's an easy road to build as far as it's a 2% crown in the middle. There's no banks or hips and stuff like that. The turnaround will be an issue. My goal is to build what I think he can survive with, meaning Jeff. We've discussed that they need a big right turn. I've seen a lot of the hammerheads or whatever around. There's plenty of room there.
That's for the turnaround you're talking
about. Correct, for his plow.
Right.
Notice that was going to be 100 by 70 foot.
So yeah, or whatever he needs. Like, you know, the radiuses weren't discussed, but I know, you know, what the goal is, I'd get subgraded before I did any select materials. Get with Jeff, and if he says, you know, if you could do this, that, or whatever, we'll do that, because it's just a matter of moving dirt or shifting. If he looks, when he looks at it, the turnaround, I don't know, a lot of them aren't crowned, they're just pitched so that the water will shed to one side. This particular spot, that would work better only because when his plows come, they're not looking at the ridge. Because if they're riding a ridge at 2%, they're not, you know, it's more work. So if he agrees, we would put that at a bank so that his plows could just come without getting involved with that ridge. There's plenty of snow stacking capabilities, if you would, off of that.
Any wetland issues at that hammerhead?
They're not. I'm not affecting half an acre.
Yeah.
At best, the wetland issues are not, like, we're not putting snow directly into the wetlands. There'll be a little bit of a buffer. And again, I'll get with him. He did want or made comment that wants to be sure that his plows can just push it off, not, you know, into some banks and things. And this site where it is perfect for that. It'll be higher than surrounding areas.
Will that be way up by where your stone wall starts?
Directly across.
Okay.
Yep. There was talk of, at the time, I just couldn't afford any legal consultation on a maintenance easement. I will have that, obviously, as part of the conditions that they wanted. There's a section there that goes off the right-of-way. And I own the land, but it would be, I'm guessing, 50 feet if it's 100 feet long or 75. That he wanted a maintenance, Jeff again, wanted a maintenance easement, only because there's areas in town that hey, that's my land, get your plow off type thing, so we don't...
I know about those.
Yeah, we don't want that to occur, that was his thoughts. And I will do that prior to obviously coming before the board for acceptance. The other issues that I saw, I will get signage, which right now is just a stop sign and a no outlet
dead end
or something. And that's not an issue, and I'll get with them as far as placement. On top is an existing culvert under Twist Hill Road, a 15-inch. Right now, tonight, there's standing water of 6 inches. I just want to make sure that's in the minutes, that the existing culvert is not fully functional, but I think I could go over by hand on the outlet side and make sure that it's relieved. It's just over the years, the sediment, through the winter, the leaves, so on and so forth, just gagged it up a little bit. It's a nice pipe, but I just want to make sure, because what happens when you get involved is all of a sudden, hey, the pipe is full.
So that one's not going to be replaced?
No, that is not going to be replaced. I do plan on extending it, and I haven't gone up there to do this yet, because I want to make sure that an engineer looks at it. There's no volume, what it could pass through. Like, there's never been an issue in that pipe. I just want to make sure. Arnonot, that actually, when he built the road in the 60s, had a little 6-inch pipe that went across the road. And that's, you know, over the years been filled in, so it's not functional. I'm going to replace it with a 12-inch concrete. Where that pipe comes under and where this will go under, it almost needs like a small, no sump to it, but a small basin with 3 holes in it so that you can get that radius that we talked about, a 75 or 25 foot radius, but it's narrow up there, you couldn't get a trailer, so the idea was to kick it out, but I have to look at it and make sure Jeff agrees and the engineer agrees.
And there's enough with that pole on the corner for that radius, Brian?
Yes.
There is?
There is.
Okay.
If I extend that pipe and put another cross pipe and so on.
And just so I know, what is the width of the right of way?
50 feet.
It is 50 all
yep.
the way out?
Yep.
To the pond?
To the pond. Yep. The only other issue, if I can babble on about this
thing, please.
The only other issue is the select materials. I purchased the gravel. On top of that is a crushed gravel. The minutes reflected well. What I discussed at the sidewalk is, at work we have a bunch of products. Most gravel pits are depleted, no one uses them anymore. We do have a reclaim. It's not what I had on the road, and it's accepted by the state, but they reclaim pavement with crushed gravel underneath it. The only reason I had commented on it, it's black. And it's not millings. It doesn't harden up. It's this exact same as crushed gravel, but it's black, and it makes a big difference on a dirt road, because the intent was not to pave this road, as stated in the minutes of the town meeting. That was just an option. I can purchase crushed gravel. It's everyone now manufactures it, maybe the town doesn't, or certain areas with Epsom and stuff that has it. But also, what I would strongly suggest, but I'll get with Jeff, I don't care one way or the other, I have to purchase material either way. And they're basically the same, in the same range of pricing, is the crushed stone, which is what's in the town yard over there, basically. Same material. His is an inch and a half. The stuff we use for the state DOT projects everywhere in towns is 2-inch. Same thing. They just take ledge, crush it up, leave the fines in it. But it doesn't matter to me. I would get the gravel base down shape so that the road basically then is stable. and then get with Jeff. If it's crushed gravel, I do have a source in Hooksett, and I just bring it up. My only concern is the horse traffic. Crushed gravel, I call them rototillers. They have destroyed that road. Every springtime, I love horses, love the farmers. Every time it's wet in the fields, they come down the road. With crushed stone, the same product that's in the town yard, you put it down, they won't bring their horses because it messes up their shoes a little bit. With crushed gravel, they will come down, they race. And it won't be my issue because they won't have the maintenance of the road. But it's just something to consider. I don't care if I look at it as the town accepts state spec standards. And in a state spec standard, you're allowed to substitute a better material. So the town accepts 304.3, which is crushed gravel. Everywhere in every town, you can substitute 304.4, which is crushed stone. But if the road agent and the selectmen don't want it, I wouldn't do it. That's all. It doesn't matter to me.
So you, no cost, or you'll do whatever Jeff wants?
Absolutely. The crushed gravel is less because they don't crush as much stone. They just add sand to the crushed stone and make the crushed gravel. But it doesn't matter to me because it will be, you know, the town's road. So that's the only issues I've run up against. As far as the neighbor can't participate, they're elderly and really don't have funds to do it. A couple times I've been asked what my end game was. The end game is, as a taxpayer, I'm getting older and tired, and I just want to make sure that if something happens to me, my wife, we could hire plows, but you know that in the big storms they're pricey. We'll be on fixed income someday when we retire, and I just, if the town, with the amount of taxes coming off the road, if they could maintain it, that's my end game. I want safety services, and I want a plow.
And that gravel is enough to do the entire road that's stockpiled there?
Close.
Yeah.
Close, but there's, you know, people do still sell gravel. Where I got this, there's more available, but I think I did it roughly, and it should be enough. The road itself had Armino that had put a foot. It's you know, it's used up and moved around, and the road's been pushed around by me and so on, but there's still, there's never been an issue as to washouts, and there's never been an issue as to people getting stuck in 30 years, I think.
I want to hear from Jeff now. Your concerns referencing this project.
Brian's pretty well addressed them all.
So you,
first thing I want to do is, first thing I want to do is thank him and his wife because they're great stewards of that pond. Because if it wasn't for them, I'm sure the place would be a disaster area. If you drove down there today, I don't think there's any trash there. And they put up with it. But that was their choice. They built the house there. This road will not go to the pond. Stop short of the pond, but there's still access to the pond. It isn't going to ruin that. He intends to leave it so everybody can have access. This turnaround that was huge, and Brian had indicated, as he did tonight, that he would make it work for us. As we talked about, you know, if he builds a nice road like this and a big turnaround, it could tend to be a parking area for people, you know, which we all understand that. And he has a parking area now, I'm sure, on his property to a certain extent, like it or
in the
not.
Winter.
Yeah, no, like it or not.
Doesn't say in the winter time, right?
Yeah. And the easement or some paperwork, so if they ever did sell the place, it's fine with them. If the next owner wouldn't create any problems with the town. So I think that's really key, and I'm sure we can come up with a dimension or size to make it work.
Okay.
That's we're all on the same page with that. That was a big concern of mine. And
come a long ways from when you used to park at the end of Armin Odette's pasture, cow pasture,
yep.
And walk that trail all the way down at night to go fishing.
Yeah. There's a lot of stories out there.
Any problem with the black recycled reclaimed material?
No, actually, we've talked about it, and Brian and I did a great length, and my only concern, he did indicate that he thought it would pack a little harder than the gravel, and I was just curious about a maintenance level for the town, if we would be able to grade it and stuff, and he assured me it wouldn't be any problem with that. We could maintain it with our equipment we got without having to buy any special equipment. And quite frankly, it might be a good thing to try, because we have some other issues with some gravel roads. Maybe we switch our product a little bit. Yeah. The top of them. It might be a good experience. It won't be a bad one, no matter what.
Yeah, okay. I just want I just said
we can look at that.
Yeah.
You know.
If it's gonna save you some dollars, that's
yeah, no, too. It's not, the savings is minimal, it's more the product, but
if it's a better product,
when
it might
do
be
you
worthwhile.
Use that? Start using it.
We're running out of gravel at our pit, yeah. So we've been buying that road base of 304.
You like that?
Yeah, 304
for
it.
Yep. So we just look at it, and if nothing else, even if it's just a fine grade layer and tight, it's the color that makes a huge difference. That hill we used to get icy all the time. The stuff I spread was rougher and had a lot more pavement in it. But the black one, as soon as the sun would hit it in February or whatever, it just
clear right up. That's what I was thinking. It'd be a win-win for the winter.
Yeah.
Brian, it didn't make it mushy. I know a lot of times the darker dirt road gets mushy, you know, in the winter.
You will have your frost bands no different than he has in the spring, but not with, because of the pitch of that road, there's just one area that gets soft because it doesn't get the sun. The rest does, so that the frost really comes and goes, but that's when the horses come down, and they just, whatever. I love horse people.
In the history, there was also a lot of discussion of getting a town engineer. Is a town engineer that's required here at this point?
Well, we were kind of on who was going to do the inspection.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, it was, if you read the minutes, we had talked, knocked around about a plan, and Wes Bryan indicated he spent enough money he was interested in.
I would feel better like at subgrade. Normally we deal with road agents just because it's a crown. And I have what's called a smart level. It's just a digital level you put it on. But we use an automated grader, so it's kind of a factual thing. But at that point, if we were to walk and look at the subgrade, I would like to have an engineer just walk it. Just so they, I haven't done drainage calcs. And if I did, I would use my own engineer with a stamp. The 15-inch pipe that was in the bottom, even on the Mother's Day flood, never overwashed. It's now an 18-inch with flared end sections, concrete. And then there's the other crossing I had was 12-inch, which is now 15-inch, but it is really not enough watershed to even.
That would probably help in acceptance if it's an engineer stamped approved?
It would be an independent party, I think, would be, don't you, Brian?
Yeah.
I mean, we're not talking about a lot of inspections.
I don't want to.
Just to.
But if he, and then my intent was, I own around the pond. I wanted the previous surveyor had surveyed it back whenever, but Bob Todd, who I hired, couldn't get it to close, he called it. And so he is coming back to make sure that it's close. I said, no, because they want it to close. There's one point there somewhere or some line that Morris Foote did it, and it doesn't close. So
on the road?
No. The road is a state issue. I didn't do any
on the
survey.
Back of your.
On that whole, it's like a 61-acre parcel around the pond. So I am going to get Bob Todd back. After the subgrade is complete, we'd probably schedule with Jeff and an engineer just to walk it and look at it and agree that the crown is there, that everything is whatever, the drainage is fine and things like that. And then I'd have Bob Todd do what I call an as-built. Because the road will meet the class 5 standards, it's not too steep, the curves aren't there, but I want, it's kind of unique that you got to fit it in what's there.
Yeah.
Because the pole are about $3,000 to move. I'm not interested in moving them. We cut one old white oak I felt bad about, but oh well. And then, so if we got to that point, I'd have it put on a flat plan. I'd have a typical cross section. At the same time, he'd have elevations. I'm sure, I don't see the need for cross sections.
So we'd have a road plan on file at the end.
You'd have a road plan with the details.
Before we accept it?
Yeah.
Sounds like, right?
I'm sure they would want it before they accept it.
Because I know some of the meetings said after the road was accepted and...
Or after subgrade it.
After
subgrade. The whole point is, if I can get it to subgrade, because if anything, you know, it's major to build it...
Then he can measure from the subgrade.
And then nothing changes from subgrade except the foot of gravel, foot of crushed gravel.
Do you have a timeline?
I don't. Still, it's just finances.
Understood.
The gravel was a big chunk, the pipes are a big chunk, clearing was as much, and but that being said, it'll progress fairly fast, and then get it green, and then after that, it's just the purchase of the crushed gravel or crushed stone.
Now, we sent this letter out, Lean, just so we could have an update from Brian on the road.
Okay. Yeah, that was pretty much. There, where we have a new board,
sure.
I'm seeing activity.
Absolutely.
Telephones are calling, coming in,
and it's in
we have no answers to the questions.
We knew that,
so.
That, you know, just been lucky and keeps winning. So
and I understood. I understood you have started some of the work project before this letter, but it was just.
I just want to make sure.
Just start, yeah.
But it's definitely a visual slam right now. But I forewarned all the neighbors in the neighborhood, but if you've driven down there or looked at it, it's clear. Joe and Ron does an awesome job. They're very talented, but what he had to deal with, and then we had that 2 inches of rain, didn't really help my case anyway. It's put back together, and I'd say within 2 months, the road will look like a road. I just want to get it to where it's stable. I haven't disturbed anything yet. The runoff doesn't go anywhere where we're concerned, but I want to make sure the slopes are shaped and covered with humus, seeded, and things like that. If they're, I have silt socks, they call them, so that. But right now everything's running clear. If there are issues, I do the.
I have a question for you,
yep.
Because I drive by there often.
Yep.
Do you own most of both sides of that road?
I own the entire right side from the pavement in.
Okay.
Limited, but I mean, it's a weird shape. But I own none of the left side till you get down to the second corner. There's a little vernal pool with a part-time brook comes down, that's my line, and then from there I own both sides out to the Purgatory Brook and both sides of the Beaver Dam and the other.
And the other person that owns the left side is the Gibsons?
Yes,
okay.
Mr. and Mrs. Gibson. There's actually, payroll used to own it the first 200 feet or so, but it's all a swamp. And that's the watershed that comes down there, very limited, but it's there. And then the Gibsons, beyond that.
What about Zilak State along their property?
He doesn't own technically to the right of way.
You come down the strip
right
next
to
there.
Yeah, I think it's a real small sliver, right?
Yeah.
Right up to...
There's a lot of history, if you would, to that. There was a man that, well, first it was Morissette's. They did a subdivision, and they have an affidavit as to what they accomplished as a stone wall, but there was another guy that, I don't know if they did this was back when the town didn't require surveys, and I think they were at the bar, and they shifted.
That's pretty polite.
Yeah, I know.
Don't put that in second. They shifted the line, and it just doesn't make sense, so...
That's why you can't get a closure on your...
No, it's not even that piece. But
okay.
I may be nice. it hasn't been recorded, but it may be nice, and it's up to Xylax to what his feeling is. If he puts it back, then everything is as per all the other surveys that were done. But if he doesn't, then it'd be, I don't care, because we're talking about a tenth of an acre, whatever.
Any question, any more?
I got one more question.
Yes.
Typically, as you know, being involved with the planning board, the town has hooked up with an engineering firm from time to time, and we use it as gentlemen now. We use an engineering firm right now that does work for the town. The guy's name is Kevin Leonard. North Point Engineering.
Yep.
Seeing how we have a bit of a relationship with him, I was thinking we probably would contact him.
As the engineer? Yeah.
Whatever.
But you'd get the bill on it.
Yep.
I can't imagine it would be outrageous.
I can't either.
But you never know.
Hopefully none of you are attorneys and engineers.
Sorry, Ken. Anyway, so that would be the deal with that.
Does the subgrade get rolled in, the vibrating roller?
This would be all rolled, graded.
I have no doubt that Brian will do it.
So even the subgrade would be much better than what's there to drive on.
It can be. And I would have to, because of the amount of traffic that goes down there.
Just to maintain some level.
Yeah, you have to. The base of the road, that's what I'm shooting for. It's just getting the crown. Some areas, there's down by the house, there's huge oaks. But if you do any cutting of the dirt, the branches are over, so you're going to, wipe out the oaks. So we're going to, there we'll raise it. You have to use good material just because of where it is. But where we don't have to, then we'll use material that'll bind up and everything, but it won't be gravel. But you have to maintain access. Yep.
Okay. Tried as I might before, I couldn't pin Brian down on a timeline.
It's finances.
I do like timelines.
Yeah.
I mean, we want to be in a position to accept the road.
Oh, that's right.
And certain requirements have to be met along the way. I'm going to ask for we have a public here, any other comments from the public? You want to ask questions of this gentleman referencing this?
I have one. Jeff, maybe help me with this one. What about survey monumentation along the road?
It's already there.
All of it?
Yep. He's not going to change those rebar that the state put in.
Yeah.
The granite bounds.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
No, that's what they
I wasn't thinking of that.
They're this well-marked. Well-defined.
It is.
Anybody could find them. And you all put witness stakes.
But I do, there's two down by the pond and Bob Todd's, or whoever.
Yeah, concrete ones.
Well, no, they're gone.
There's one on the left.
Yeah.
On the right when you go in, on the left the ones are gone?
No. They're there, but way down where
the pond. Yeah, I don't know anything about that.
Yeah. And so I do want to know where that is, just for bearing. That's changed through the years. Yeah.
Can I interrupt? Ken, yeah. Would you repeat your question? Because I didn't quite get it all.
Is there adequate physical survey monumentation along the road?
Okay.
To the satisfaction of the town and the road agent, really?
That was Ken Swayze for the public.
Actually, there's more than ordinarily.
There is.
There's a lot of
Brian, I want to say thank you for coming in
and
explaining it to us, and just to keep charging on.
I appreciate it. Hopefully I can, and this year will make a big difference. Yeah. I'm hoping to get the gravel on it after all the engine, but it's all a hiring.
Yeah. I would only ask you to keep in close communication with that road agent.
I will. If you get complaints, just kind of, you'll know what's going on. Thank you, gentlemen. And
thank you.
Dean.
Thank you, Brian.
I just want to talk to you a minute outside.
All right. For
a
second.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, ma'am.
How detailed do you want all his explanation?
You can, I would just say it would provide us an update, a general discussion, an update of the Purgatory Road.
And put a few details
here.
Well, I would like it to be as detailed as possible, because he's re-emphasized his points and what he's willing to do.
The building points, right.
So I would like it as detailed as you can get off of that tape and make it, because he's re-emphasized in his previous meeting.
Half of it's on.
Okay.
Okay.
But the thing is, he really did, I was going through the minutes from previously, he essentially reaffirmed what he was, what he was doing.
And that's what I want, because this is a meeting many, many years after, and he, that's why I asked him specific issues.
These are from 2012.
Right.
Can you, do you have that, or that you can email it to me?
I already did.
Oh, you already did?
I sent it in Word, so you can.
All right, I saw all those, I didn't have a chance, I got it on.
Most of those materials, other than the one that's when they rip up the black dock.
Right, and the standards are 50 feet, the right of way being 50 feet, everything.
So that minute, I could use some of that if I can't quite hear it right?
He reaffirmed what you were asking. Good, no, that's.
He reaffirmed every subject in there, but the reason I asked him those questions, Corin, is to make sure that he re-emphasized them in today's date. Because a lot of times things change and people don't do what they said they would do.
It may be another year or two before he gets it, before he comes to the board for acceptance.
As specific as you can get it.
Yeah, because he was gonna clear out the culverts too for near.
He's gonna do that anyway, yeah.
Okay. So be it, sorry, it's gotta be a little more detailed. And I.
On this one at least.
I'll bow down to, I think it makes sense. Common sense.
Yeah, I'll try this best I can.
Okay. Moving on, okay, we had a, as I said earlier, we had a, I'm gonna go directly into the town maintenance issue with the library.
Okay.
We had a, earlier we had, we walked about it, and we just talked about a few ideas as far as how we wanna approach question bids from paint. Let's talk about the paint first. And I think the, we have a painter coming tomorrow at 8:45. I'll meet with the painter, and I was gonna ask him, based upon your gentleman's input, but I was gonna ask, we're gonna do the trim, and then trim and then complete, complete paint job.
Complete building, and then two sides this year and two sides next year, how much it would change his pricing. As Bob kind of suggested last.
Okay. So that concerns painting. And I'll,
for two quotes?
Well, for two quotes from this one particular painter as a start.
Okay, right.
Yeah.
Four and then two and then two. Okay.
Yeah, so as suggested from the public last week, I was able to get a hold of Tuttle from the sign. He returned my call, so he's, I've scheduled an appointment with Mike for tomorrow morning.
Yeah. And that will be one, I think. This is a huge job, so it's going to require more than one quote, of course.
Yeah.
Well, also, can you get a timeline so we can see if he can fit it in this summer? And when he could possibly start it?
Start
and finish, yeah.
You thought you might be able to forward?
Yeah, I was. I just got back from Rhode Island, 1 o'clock today, so I will.
The other painters you're talking about?
Yes.
Okay.
Painters and roofers. Yeah. I sent you an email. So it's
okay, the second thing we look at. We noticed the door, which needs a carpenter to probably do the door.
Front entrance door.
Rear entrance door,
which was on the list of improvements from last year that needed to be looked at.
Right.
No, I think it was brought up after.
But regardless,
but regardless there is some additional funds there to do that. Okay.
And I do have a couple of, I would say smaller carpenters that would be able to get a job that size that I can give you names of so we get some estimates.
Okay.
But at the same time, there was something aesthetically I found that you pointed out was aesthetically, it made the town look like crap because of the library sign, the last word is writing off.
This is the front, this is the roadside.
Right.
That's classified the last, as the front,
right?
Yeah. Right?
The last four letters are, the bottom halves are rotting, so we're gonna look at the repair of that sign.
I would have a carpenter look at that for a bit at the same time. What do we get for carpenters? Have a look at the sign too?
Yep. We did have someone, do you recall who did that as a volunteer?
I think Judy Keefe. Why am I wanting
to say
that name?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, it is.
And I think they purchased a stencil specifically for that purpose.
Yeah.
I think the town may still have that.
They were in the basement for the longest time. Not in my office, but I do recall that one of those storage rooms there were.
But what's required, the stencil is one thing, it's having the wood.
I almost wondered when they made that, if they didn't do that last section, because the seam, maybe the last section isn't exterior grade plywood.
Something is different, it looks like it's waferboard on the end there to me. So.
Ah.
We'll look into that and maybe get that last section redone, and if we can look for that stencil, that would be a great help to have it.
I don't remember seeing it.
Okay.
In the library.
You know what, I bet you if we called Judy, she might even have it at her house.
I think she said she gave it back, because it was Judy and Les Hammond that collaborated on that.
Do you think you can look into that, Wayne, and let us know?
The only other thing, if the library is open, if it's anywhere, it's in that cage in the basement.
Right, that's where I would, I'm almost vaguely overseeing.
We saw a couple of other issues that we, Bob, you talked about the air conditioner, which is fine.
Yeah, well, Lena and I talked about that.
Okay.
I can take care of that.
All right. Andy, what was other?
The rainwater from the two back, the rear entry roofs drips onto the bulkhead roof, and which drips onto the door, which is rotting the door, so we could replace that door, and 2 years down the road, we're going to have the same issue. So I think we need to look at gutters, at least on the rear entry roofs there, coming down next to the pilaster with a...
Could I ask you, to me, that's a small job as far as costs.
Yeah.
Could you take the lead on that as far as getting an estimate?
Yeah, I will.
Okay, I want to make sure we have that.
And I'll work with Lean to get the contractor for that door too.
Okay. Yeah, when the gutter, carpenters don't do that. You gutter people do it pretty.
Yeah, that's pretty. The technology for that, they have the machine, it just comes out in one piece.
And the only other thing is, we all talked about, is the panic device on the door doesn't allow it to be locked and unlocked from the inside of the panic device, which on a town safety issue, they may want to do.
I'm not sure I understand that.
If we had a lockdown.
You can't lock from the interior of the building, like these.
They're not like a normal panic like these to release. So there's no release from the inside, so.
So you're saying when we install the new door, that should be something.
We look at the panic device as well. And again, we'll try and get a panic device that looks similar to the one on there, because I know they make them. They don't have to be a new retrofit style. So it'll look a little more authentic, I think.
Okay, and then the big monkey in the room was the steel.
And in reference to the steel, we're going to send the certified letter out to the contractor and start there.
Mm-hmm.
And then once that process happens, then we'll go from there on the steel, I would think.
Okay, you guys last week asked me to check with the town council and see if that was the correct step. And she replied that absolutely, your opinion was to get them certified, then also send it regular mail.
Yep.
Do you want that to be drafted in-house, or do you want that to come from the town attorney?
I think the town attorney draft it, and you can sign it, Lane, and then we'll send it out.
Yep, okay.
That was a consensus some of us related to.
Is it legal for Lane to sign the letter, or
is
it selectmen to sign it?
Town administrator.
Okay. You're getting into the time of year where they're going to be real busy, and so somehow we have to hold our feet to the fire. We have a contract. We didn't write the number. They gave us a number we worked with.
Yep.
So it's either, and they think, you know, our attorney could hold them. It may take a while to go to court, unfortunately, but either they're going to do it or someone's going to do it and they're going to get billed.
Right.
But it just takes a while to collect it.
Now, Lee, can you do me a favor and just ask the town attorney if you know the selectmen need to sign the letter, you need to sign it.
Okay.
Yeah, just to be sure.
Yeah, I'll just confirm that.
Especially if we end up in court.
That's a lot of times, too, if it's a timing factor, if I happen to get it sooner, one selectman enough for me to just get a hold of someone and sign it.
Okay. All right, can I end the library discussion?
Yep.
There's one other thing.
Okay.
Where the wellhead is.
Oh, yes.
It's just
the
metal plate. But if you give me a little time to think about it, because I know you can raise that up so the water's not going in. Use masonry and mortar, you know. It's what we would put on the top, whether it's if I use blocks and we have a metal plate with holes in a drill so you can bolt it down,
yep,
so people can take it off after if they had to.
Yep.
But at the same time, kids can't go over, you know, they made a point. Small kid could go over.
12-inch hole there, a kid could easily go down in if they were playing, but the plates could be lifted off with one finger.
Or they give some trash receptacle.
They go down in there, that, you know, that would have been a perfect example of what could happen.
Did you go in the basement to look at that little?
No, I just lifted it up and saw the hole dropped right down.
This is in the basement?
This is outside the library.
Well cover.
Well cover, adjacent to the library building, for the town water supply.
And it's been like that for a long time, so something needs to be done tomorrow, but we should look at it.
All right, the library put the bed for now?
I would say those are, and then we'll get back to it.
Yeah, we'll do that as a follow-up, okay. So I'll start with, I'll coordinate the first bid, but we want to keep it the same, so we're not always comparing apples, we're comparing apples and apples forward. All right, other town business, let's keep going on. All right, this is just a FYI. Lean explained to me that they had a little trouble with the, we approved the amount of money to be spent on getting the area security in here. Mm-hmm. They needed to install a $225 additional panel to make it work. And that was
that for the motion detector?
Yes.
Yeah.
And
we,
that's what we thought.
We tried to work it off of the one panel, and in order to secure the selectman's office independently from the motion, an additional panel was required in the hallway, and then in order for the hallway motion to be able to be controlled without affecting...
Remember, I thought that might be the case,
yeah,
and everybody said,
and
no, it'll all be controlled off that one. I didn't think it was a good idea to do anyway.
So he was able to... he's recommending that anyone who opens the office in the morning go through that main door to be closer to the panel to disarm the motion area, and then they can... work from there. In the future, he's still recommending that we secure all the doors, but the motions will definitely pick up any movement in the building as the way they're set up right now.
To include raccoons.
So there is an additional
Can we make sure
$25
goes out too, that we notify all the departments that have a key? So.
Yeah.
You're going to have it going off a lot for no reason.
I plan on it.
I have a meeting next Monday. Is this going to affect me? The awareness committee has a meeting next Monday.
Yeah, I'll have the emails going out.
Great, thanks.
I just need to make sure
it was
tested.
I don't want to be the first one to send it.
I wanted to make sure it was tested and running properly, and then, so you probably
We're almost there. She's working out the kinks.
Yeah. So I'm all set to go with the initial expense.
Okay, I ran in this morning. I ran into
this is all the mailbox.
Yes, the mailbox. We submitted let me get this right. Perambulation results were submitted to the state and accepted by the state. And I'll give you that so you can think of that.
Yeah, really.
I think you got a copy of that.
I do.
Yeah.
Good.
Okay. And so kudos to everyone who went out and walked along.
I didn't walk.
I noticed.
I thought that was a nice letter from the town of Hopkinton, Selectmen.
Yeah.
To acknowledge that, you know, this is an important thing to maintain. And so kudos to Fred.
Yep. Yeah. He was very happy that it was accepted and he submitted it this morning to the state. Okay. That's already talked about. That's old. That's my copy. All right, this is from the, we have an email from the Ethics Committee.
Yeah, you asked me to follow up and find out if
there's
been another meeting scheduled,
right,
which we thought would be in May. We kind of lost track of time, so I think with summer months coming up, we both agreed it probably be better to hold it after summer.
Okay. I disagree.
For real?
Yes, I do. I'll probably be out of office by the time I get it, and that defeats the purpose of another selectman recommending I get the ethics training. So they ask them to put on an ethics training, for God's sake, we don't have to wait 4 months for it. I think this is unacceptable. I'm sorry.
Really?
Yes. We can't wait that long.
Well, the thing is, you can attend any one of their meetings monthly and have a personal one-on-one, but when you're looking to schedule a meeting that's convenient for others during the course of the day or anything.
But the thing is, October, I'm talking, I'll be out of office by then, almost. I mean, January's coming around, and I'll be out of office, and I want to, I read the,
Mike, most ethics things are common sense. Bob and I'll keep you on track.
I know. I would ask you this, can we look at that? Maybe target the first 2 weeks of June, before the school gets out. Because no one's going on vacation with the kids in school.
I hate to say it.
I know. But the thing is, I just think it's too long to wait.
But again, if they meet monthly, you could attend that meeting.
If they're going to have it in conjunction with one of their meetings, I'd say that's all great. We can announce it. Everyone who wants to go for that little bit of maybe 45 minutes of ethics training, fantastic. I'd be all in favor of that, and I would attend the meeting.
Because it doesn't take long. I mean,
just remember, they did have it once, and you missed it.
I know. And so the thing is, I'm asking, but the thing is, the public also asked for another day other than a Tuesday. We had other members of the community.
It was only me and you.
No, there was other people in the audience. Yes, you guys stand correct there. Okay, so Lee, if you would be so kind.
I'll follow up again, yep.
We have to all sign that, please.
Yep. Any other business?
Well, we have a non-public.
We do. And we have business, what do you want to bring to your attention?
So we're going on other business now? You've done your mailbox, right?
Yeah, well, other business.
Do you want to, Joan, what do you to bring up this?
Yep.
Want to come up and explain to you?
Yeah, basically what you guys have there are pictures.
Could you state your name for the camera there?
Patrick.
There we go.
Thank you.
What you have there are pictures of the compactor building and the attendant shed.
Yep.
We've been noticing shingles around the yard.
Pretty well worn.
Yeah, I brought it to the Selectmen, you know, partly through last year. We found a few here, a few there. Well, I had a gentleman fly that with his drone, go over top of it and take a peek, and a couple of those pictures are the backside of the compactor building. You can see where his actual shingles look like they're missing, and it might possibly even be a rot hole in there.
Just to help me out, the compactor building is the one down away from the main building.
Yes, that's the one where the trash goes in, and the attendant shed is directly across from it.
The attendant shed doesn't look near.
That doesn't look too bad at all. It's the other.
Is this the compression shed?
Compactor.
Excuse me.
And your main building is steel, you said?
Yes, that's a steel roof. That one's been patched, I think, twice. It still has some leak issues, but.
Is this one leaking at all right now?
I have no idea, the way of knowing, because it's a...
It's partially open.
It's open and it's sealed. There's wood up at the top. Man, I don't see any rod up there on the inside, but I don't know what it's doing.
I don't
roofing
think
roofing material.
The shingles are double coated. It's probably not leaking, but it is time to replace them.
Yep.
But I think that, you know, when we're getting this cap price, maybe we could... That's not that large a building. We could send somebody over to get an estimate on it at the same time. Mm-hmm. You know, two different jobs, but...
And I think do whatever we have to do just to button it up for this year and then we'll do something next year. Because I know we had a bunch of other projects. And I don't think it'll take much to, I'm not a roofer, but I don't think it'll take much to button that up so that we can just get through this year with it and then do something next year, plan it and do it next year.
And the thing is, as far as materials, I would go with the an upgraded shingle on it too, like the architectural shingle. Someone said the price difference between a straight flat shingle and an architectural shingle is minimal.
I pulled the paperwork, what I have down there, and basically what I have is just some big paperwork from that project. I don't have the actual, what was used on the building. It must be up here somewhere. I have no idea. I don't even know if it's even up here.
Well, the only thing, the architectural shingles are the ones that look fancy, but aside from being fancy, they have a longer warranty because they're thicker.
Yeah.
And so it lasts a little longer, and the price difference is minuscule.
Those have been on there about 15 years.
Okay. So you probably got a 20-year flat shingle.
Like I said, I tried to find paperwork.
25-year.
Couldn't find anything on it.
You agree with it, go with a little better building product?
I've seen that the 3 temps tend to hold up sometimes as well as the architecture. It depends, but
Oh, we can get cold.
The architectural's now a limited lifetime.
That building's not heated. That building's not heated, so that's probably why it's lasted.
Should last quite a long time.
It's a matter of a couple of dollars.
You're gonna get me names, right?
Yeah.
Okay, because I've got one quote that I'm waiting.
Yeah.
Yeah, Woody, I think we can, we're gonna pursue quotes on this.
Yeah, but like I said, I don't think it's a super high priority.
I'm looking at how worn they are.
Just replace it now.
Yeah, no, it's time.
We're just gonna keep breaking.
Time to fix it.
And I don't think it's a huge expense there to re-roof that compared to, you know, if you patch, you're gonna spend half your money.
You sure you don't want a slate roof?
You stand under that 30-foot drop when the snow comes off, I'm not interested in being down there.
You have to do some metal bracing.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Appreciate the pictures. It was a good idea to bring the, whoever brought that, the going up on it. Save someone from going up on a ladder.
Yeah.
Okay, any other business before we go into... Lane?
Nope.
I got a couple.
Okay. Bob's out.
You're going to do that when you come
yes.
back? Okay, I just wanted to make sure before I mess up here.
Okay, walking around the town common.
Yes.
Everybody notices that the flowers are growing and everything, but somebody put them there. So I'm looking for a consensus from the select board to thank the, or show appreciation to the garden club because they did all the planting out there. And though we haven't gotten them any bark mulch yet, the plants look good, you know. And
yeah, we do have that budget, and so it's usually a communication.
The garden club president said we're going to skip it for this year, and she's just asked the members as we do our weekly stuff, because we've signed on for weeks, that we just take our rake and fluff it up. We can get by without mulch this year.
Oh, okay.
Okay?
Yeah.
But regardless, it looks good.
Oh, good.
And
I
think they should have, I think we should send them a letter of appreciation. And the second one, only because I talked to one of the people that was involved with the Arts on the Common, which contributes that money to the Town Hall Restoration Committee, and even though it's a 501c3, the investment is into that second floor, so it saves the townspeople money if something happens, you know, when they do develop that. And so you have, I'm going to say ringleaders, which is Pat Murphy, Don Larson, and Enid Larson. They get involved with getting all the particulars arranged, and then they have a great amount of volunteers from the town that either, you know, selling tickets or giving directions or, you know, moving people around from wherever they want them to head to. So. If we could give them a letter of appreciation, because it is money that's earned, and it's helped even Dawn a little bit with REITs.
Do you think just putting something on the website so that people can see that on the front homepage?
But I think that them receiving something
personal.
Yeah.
But I think that the website would reach out to all the people that gave a little bit of time.
Well, I think maybe we could put it as a website thing, but also send that letter out.
Yeah.
And I think that's important only because it's been, you know, you look around at the volunteers in town, and did last Saturday, and they're all, you know, gray-haired, just about, and it's hard to get young people involved, so if they get a chance to go to the website, they might find out there are things to get involved with in the town.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yep.
So that's my spiel.
I think we got a 100% consensus.
And I know you dye your hair, so I know.
Oh my God.
I just cut it. That's all I do.
Just kidding.
Thank you, sir. Anything for
the...
Well, we do have an update on a piece of on some.
Well, no, I'm going to check into a little further.
Oh, okay.
We gave you some information.
Okay. With
we're going to come back.
Work in progress.
Okay. Whatever it is. Okay.
So not to hold everyone up, we're going to go back to public comment and we'll do non-public after. Okay, so I'm open up to the public again. I'll start this side.
I figured you'd ask me about the Stark Bridge. That's why I came back in.
Oh.
All right.
I mean, I feel a little sad that you didn't even think of it.
Well, actually, now you could look like one of the public.
You must have good news because you would have never come back in.
I figured that would be a question, seeing I was a captive audience. That's why I told you I'd be back. We,
far as I know, we got everything submitted correctly. We just, the gal we had to hire to write a nice little story about the history of that culvert bridge, which is kind of interesting. She'll have a copy of it to share with you. And she submitted it to the state, and they just have to review it. There was no findings that it had historical value in her opinion, other than the fact that it had kind of a nice story with it. There was a little, maybe we were able to pin the age of it down a little more. My information was based on what the state had given us when they did the inspection of it, and they always use 1960 for a date, and that's what I had told that gal.
So it was part of the Corps of Engineers?
It was back in the 30s. Sometime around then, there was quite, I guess, a bit of extensive research done by another gentleman. And he listed a lot of those type of steel arch culverts. And that seems to be the time frame when a lot of them were put in, pre-World War II, and then during World War II, with the shortage of metal, they kind of got away from that for a while. And then after World War II, they started to go to the steel and concrete spans and all that, because of the big, you know, Eisenhower and all the roads and all that business. So that's what she kind of pinned down, is that was maybe the time frame. Nobody's sure. There's no real documentation.
So the 30s?
Yeah, that's what she thought. But, you know, it's a, I guess those type of culverts were fairly inexpensive at the time, and they could do them with manual labor for the most part. They have sections that bolted together.
My favorite question, timeline then.
Yeah, well, they've got that. That shouldn't be an issue. We're just waiting to hear back from the state on all those four items we talked about, the dewatering, the stamp on the plan.
Right.
They submitted all that stuff back. Haven't heard back on that. Monday, I'm meeting with a guy from Mitchie, and we're very confident. There's been no other significant changes, like size or anything. As far as we know, those few items have been addressed, and it shouldn't be a problem. But we'll get a definite price and figure about the schedule and when they can make it. But they don't have a big backlog with them right now, so.
Sounds like we made some.
So next Thursday, I'll have some paperwork for you.
Excellent.
I'll be back with that. But we don't have the permit per se in hand. But
the permit.
Yeah. Those were the four concerns that we talked about. Brass Main and Rock Bob brought up. Those were the only areas we had to address. So we addressed them all and set them back in. Three of them were pretty academic. Again, like I said. Wetland scientist stamp signed and
checking the box.
Yeah, and the other thing was just the dewatering type thing. We submitted a plan showing how that's going to be taken care of. So
okay.
Fingers crossed, there shouldn't be a problem. And this historical inventory thing, just
the bridge from 30s.
That's about it.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, they did mention the fact that. That type of stonework with all those round stones cemented together was, how did they put it? Most towns didn't go to that extravagance, but I guess Dunbarton decided to go for whatever reason. So it was interesting.
We look forward to seeing it.
Yeah, so that's where we're at with that. No big hitches or anything. We kind of didn't get that report back from the gal till I think it was Monday or Tuesday. So that was kind of up in the air. That's how it came back.
So what's our next step for going forward?
The permit.
We'll get a price from them, a definite price,
mm-hmm.
and be inserted in the scheduling. The permit too, but it should all happen within the next few days, I would assume, as far as I know. I mean, we can, I guess what I'm getting at is, before we were pretty concerned, like the size of it might have to change again or something, but any of those parts seem to pass muster. So
you could be able to come back next week.
Yeah, exactly, with some paperwork. That's what my goal is, because we'll have to. The only way they'll put us in a schedule is to sign a contract, right? I mean, then we're tentatively in the schedule, subject to it. But
we're not official because we don't have our paperwork.
Yeah, I mean, if town X, Y, or Z goes over to them tomorrow with a contract and says, "Hey, you want us to build this bridge," and they'll say, "All right, we'll build yours," and Dunbar will be after you. You know, because that's how it works.
Business.
Yeah, that's how it works.
Yeah. Well, we look forward to Thursday.
Yeah, I'm hoping that'll be all a good thing.
You're always welcome to come back.
Yeah, well, like I said, I figured out, I was surprised Bob didn't mention it or something. I said, yeah, here's my chance. And I snuck out, and I said, I'll go back in. I could have just kept going.
Okay.
Thank you, Jeff. Thanks for coming back.
Yep.
Well, actually, I have a couple questions for Jeff.
Sure.
Jeff, who is this paid person at the state level that has this history? I ask because I have never found in any of our archives that I have access to any history on it, except I did find something in the McNeil family history that alluded to the McNeils married into the Starks, that there may have been a prior bridge there.
I'm sure there was.
Yeah.
Because that used to be the main road.
Right.
There was a sawmill down there in Colonial.
Right. I did.
So I'm sure there was a stone culvert at some point.
So
but that was replaced by the...
And actually, when Dunbarton put that bridge up, there was a brass plaque installed. It disappeared through the years. I do have some oral history from people on that. But, so yeah, they got fancy with the stones and a brass plaque. But who's the person I get the history from?
Yeah, I can't remember the gal's name on top of my head. I'll get the stuff to Lee and get it from her.
Okay, that'd be great.
Do you have an email?
She'll have a copy of the report.
Right, sure. Mm-hmm. It's coming electronically.
Good, then I can collect it from her.
Yeah.
Thanks.
She cited some sources.
Good, because I'd like to have them.
Some of it was kind of, I think, put together to form a story.
Okay.
Whatever.
But I had one other thing. Gil and I usually, every year since we're the last band standing from the Town Common Project, check out the bandstand and do what needs to be done this year. We checked it out, got the ladder, climbed up. There's no critters living out there. I found one little carcass, but it had been cannibalized, and there's nothing up there. There's no nut stashes. Everything looks fine. We are losing, we've lost about a half a dozen of the shingles off the roof, which we expect. They've got the crunchies, just like this one did. Mm-hmm. There's no leakage. We took a good look. But we are going to have to look at doing something with that roof at some point. And since our funds are just doing nothing but going down because there's no fundraising, obviously, I am going to check with Paul Modulesky and get some input from him as to what might be feasible in a couple of years. I just don't want to all of a sudden have, with all that intricate cutting, as you know, I don't want to just all of a sudden have a big problem with the bandstand roof and not have a backup plan.
Donna, what's on there for roof now?
The same stuff that was on the town hall.
And they didn't replace that one?
No.
They would. I filed a claim on it and they wouldn't.
No.
Because it wasn't a
Donna, what about going with an authentic wood shingle like I see in a lot of the bandstands?
Well, thank you for using the word bandstand. The reason we didn't go with wood the first time around is we didn't want it to look like a backyard gazebo. We wanted it to have the appearance of a real bandstand. And we probably had 100 pictures of bandstands, and most of them really didn't have the wood shingles. However, that may be the only thing we can get that's cost effective. I'm going to wait and talk to Paul. Somebody suggested metal. I'm going to take the cue from Jeff Trexler, and you don't want something taking off like a whirly bird. I don't think that's an option. Asphalt shingles would cheap as heck. So I think we're just going to have to check and see what's available for product.
Now, they do make some high-end architectural shingles that will have a similar look to that.
That's going to be in the research plan.
So they have those, and then I still think the wood shingles look the most authentic on them.
Well, there are different grades of that, too. So
right.
I'm going to just, again, this isn't happening overnight. We're just trying to get some information in case it does happen. The other thing is the floor's holding up well. The paint doesn't look like we need any paint. Probably can get through another couple of years with that. All the work we did on the railings and the arches are fine. The powder coating is fine. But we do have some more column cracks. Not to the extent that we're going to have to replace columns like we did before, but there's small ones, but there's one big one that's about this tall. It's not a structural issue, it's an aesthetic issue, but we want to find some way to fix it. So we just have to get a little more information about the composite material. I think we're just going to drill the little hole, fill the stuff, get the right account kind of stuff that will mix with whatever the resin is that will bind properly, and then just do some repairs and see if we can.
Are they fiberglass columns?
What were they? You and I picked them up.
I think they're like a
polyresin or something.
That's a fiberglass column.
But they're hollow. Are they?
Well, they have the PTs in the middle. Some have additional concrete, but we really should. We're just going to try to fix it. It is not a structural issue. structures
inside. Do you know
the
manufacturer of them?
We got them from the place in Manchester on...
Harvey, was it?
Harvey.
Yeah.
And I did find the original invoice on
yeah.
them.
Yeah, you had a whole book
paperwork.
On it.
I had a
yeah.
whole book on it.
Yeah.
I did find it. So it's a matter of calling them and asking them what that product consisted of, the material was compatible
for repair
a compound. Yeah.
yeah. I don't think they're familiar with the financing behind this, but there is a checkbook.
Right. That money was raised over the course of 7 years for the primarily the bandstand, but to also leave a maintenance fund so that,
yeah.
you know, if we had a problem like yeah. some, that we would be able to repair it and not have to go to the town for
and
dollars.
And then I did file a claim, and they didn't refund us 100% like they
but
did
they
for
gave
the town.
Us something.
And they gave us a few grand, and we put it in, the board authorized
putting it back,
deposit
yeah.
into the fund.
Knowing
so.
That we would have to do the roof
eventually.
At some point,
yeah.
eventually.
Yeah.
So, so just, the inspection's been done from this year, there's no real issues with it, and we'll just
that's
proceed.
Coming.
They're coming, you know.
Okay.
2008, I think we've done okay so far.
We wouldn't put that in the midst to make sure we have that. Update some maintenance issues regarding the.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
It was all done 2008, right?
2008, yeah. We just have minor wear and tear issues right now. But we are looking at a new roof in the.
Yeah,
I think a lot of the material you picked was really a good solid
it
choice.
It was. That's why we went with cast iron. That's why we chose.
That Trex decking. It was just a lot of good planning there.
Yeah. Very solid.
Okay, we're gonna at this point we're gonna adjourn for about 1 minute, and then we'll go into another one.